Welcome to our online broadcast. I'm Stuart, and I'm a member of the parish here at St James in Emmanuel Didsbury in Manchester. We're a church with a vision that is simple: to help people belong in community, believe in the transformational gospel of Jesus, and become disciples of a loving, inclusive God. Today is the third Sunday after the Epiphany, and we'll begin by praising God in song. Afterwards, I'll share my thoughts on the passage today from Jonah, which we will hear during my reflection.
How lovely on the mountain are the feet of him who brings good news. Good news. Announcing peace, proclaiming news.
Imagine we are in Jerusalem after the Jewish people have returned from exile in Babylon. We hold an inquiry into why God punished us by sending us into exile. One of the theories put forward is that it was because we are not pure enough. We had departed from the ways of God, marrying the wrong people, perhaps from outside tribes and so on. We therefore start an exercise to purge the Jewish people of such impurities in order to render us as pure, truly God's people, who will then deserve and enjoy the divine blessing. Then, in the midst of this exercise, somebody stands up and starts to tell a story about a man called Jonah. God speaks to Jonah and tells him to go and make God's message to the people of Nineveh. Jonah packs his bags and heads off. However, instead of travelling to Nineveh, which would be in Iraq today, he gets on a boat to Tarshish, probably in the south of Spain. So completely the wrong direction. God then brings about a storm, which has the mariners on the boat asking the same question: what have we done wrong that God is now punishing us through this storm? Through a long discussion, Jonah ends up being thrown overboard in an attempt to save the boat and the mariners. He's then swallowed by a big fish. Whilst in the fish for 3 days, Jonah gets his head together and prays. God then speaks to the fish, and Jonah is, quote, spewed out upon the dry land. In the Monty Python film Life of Brian, there's a scene in which Brian tries to tell a story in the form of a parable. He starts off, "There was a man who had two servants." And then a voice pipes up from the audience, "What were their names?" Brian tries to argue and say, "Well, it doesn't really matter. It's just a story. I don't know." And they come back and say, "Well, what do you mean you don't know?" Now, I would suggest that in this story about Jonah, for us to be preoccupied with questions such as, was the big fish a whale? And how can a man live inside a whale for 3 days? Is to miss the point of the story. We'll now have our reading. Our scripture passage today is Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 to 5.
The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And he cried out, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. This is the word of the Lord.
The first thing I want us to notice in this passage is that the word of the Lord comes to Jonah a second time. We can imagine that there were initially conflicting voices in Jonah's head. Go to Nineveh. But they are not pure. They are not God's chosen people. I don't want to do that. And so on. Throughout the story, Jonah wrestles with these various voices. Even when he finally does go to Nineveh, we might wonder how enthusiastic he is about his mission. But don't we often have different and sometimes conflicting thoughts as we debate and wrestle with ourselves? How to discern which of these voices is the word of the Lord? I wish I could give a simple, straightforward answer to this question, but maybe I can offer two ideas. The first is the principle of love that we see underpinning the teaching and practice of Jesus. God's embrace of the nation comes not just from the incarnation of Christ and the visit of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. It was there in the call of Abraham in Genesis 12, where God speaks to Abraham and says, "And in you all of the families of the earth shall be blessed." So we can ask, in the midst of all of these voices, which is the voice advocating the way of love? The second idea is about the unseen presence of biases and prejudices in our thinking. In our story, the Jewish people are creating an us, the pure, God's blessed, and of them, the impure, the heathen. We see this us and them pattern again in Acts 10 in the story of Peter and Cornelius. Peter initially resists the vision and says, no, I can't go. But God calls him to go and see Cornelius. And then again in the early church, the Gentiles are initially told they have to become Jews in order to experience God's blessing. And the apostles have to sort out the message that this is not necessary. The heartbeat of the Church for Everyone initiative is the notion that there are folks around us and in our midst who are made to feel that they do not or cannot belong in our community or even in the body of Christ. This can be for reasons associated with history and culture, perhaps through unconscious legacy assumptions of racial stereotypes, or maybe as a result of our theology, perhaps in the requirement that one's sexuality conforms to an assumed correct interpretation of Scripture. Or perhaps it's to do with a presumed lack of faith in one's resistance to the Spirit, who can heal or transform us from some disability or difference. Or it may simply result from a fear of the unknown. All of these have one thing in common, that they are based on the belief that there is some ideal spiritual normality that we need to satisfy or conform to in order to belong within God's people. Brian McLaren, in his podcast series Learning to See, identifies and discusses 13 biases that can reinforce our sense of us and them. McLaren notes that these are often our brain's way of handling the complexity of life, but that by becoming aware of them and conscious of them, we can make adjustments where necessary. It is this sense of bias and prejudice that the story of Jonah caused the Jewish readers of the time, and now us, to address, to become aware of, and to repent of. And the final point to note from our reading is that, surprise, surprise, the people of Nineveh responded positively to God's message. Sometimes we will find that in reaching out to those who are other or different, we may find that they have a surprising amount to contribute to our community of faith.
All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. You go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. You stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. When you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
Let us pray. First, some lines from an old hymn. Thou whose almighty word chaos and darkness heard and took their flight, hear us as humbly we pray. Lord, we pray for the world. And where do we start? Chaos and darkness seem ever present. In these times, how we need your almighty word. We pray earnestly for peace in so many parts of the globe. We pray for refugees and those displaced by war. May the governments of nations come together to resolve conflict and give aid to those in peril and fear. We pray for the agencies and charities that take on this task. We pray for those in the caring professions and thank them for the gifts they offer to others. But may vocation not be used as a byword or excuse not to respond with fair remuneration. We pray for all the mission partners in various parts of the world that we here at St. James and Emmanuel support. We pray especially today for the group of trustees and others flying this week to visit Potter's Village in Kisoro, Uganda. May their time there be inspiring and may they return safely. We pause for a moment to bring to you, loving Lord, those we know in need of your healing touch. We give thanks for the lives of those departed and those for whom this time of year is an anniversary of loss. Lord, give comfort to those who miss their loved ones and mourn. And we conclude these prayers with the one our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We finish with this Ignatian prayer. Teach me your way of looking at people. As you glanced at Peter after his denial, as you penetrated the heart of the rich young man and the hearts of your disciples, I would like to meet you as you really are, since your image changes with whom you come into contact. Remember John the Baptist's first meeting with you, and the centurion's feeling of unworthiness, and the amazement of those who saw miracles and other wonders. How you impressed your disciples, the rabble in the Garden of Olives, Pilate and his wife, and the centurion at the foot of the cross. I would like to hear and be impressed by your manner of speaking, listening, for example, to your discourse in the synagogue in Capernaum or the Sermon on the Mount, where your audience felt you taught as one who has authority. Amen. So let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord.